chapter 55. While you're turning there, we're going to do a little bit of a review. Then we're talking about God's will and suffering. By way of review, we've talked about the nature of suffering. Recognize that suffering is difficult by its very nature, right? But we need to we remember that all suffering is relative. We need to be very careful about minimizing someone's suffering. It could be on the scale of someone just simply not getting their way, which is frustrating and discouraging, all the way up to the worst possible suffering you could imagine, and you can just imagine that. But we need to, again, remember that that is a relative thing. Sometimes, when it comes to suffering, it's painfully obvious or very clear, easy to see what the cause is, why, and how, and all that. Other times, suffering seems more random. It seems more causeless. It's hard to understand how or why. But that leads us to a very, very important point. Jesus made it very, very clear that while it is true that all suffering is the result of sin, it does not necessarily mean that it is the result of your sin, or that if you see someone suffering, that it is the direct result of their sin. That is not automatic. Again, Jesus made that very, very clear. So, and we need to talk about the dangers of suffering, and the primary danger of suffering is that it makes us emotional. It takes us away from our thinking, rational mind, and puts us into an emotional state. And the problem with that is emotional people don't make sound decisions. They don't think very clearly. They don't come to very sound decisions. Very often when we find ourselves in an emotional state, we're asking the wrong question, and you can't get the right answer if you're not even asking the right question. Amen? So that leads us to moving on to the purpose of suffering. And you know, one of the most important steps or one of the most important facets or ways to deal with pain, to deal with suffering, is to understand its purpose. Now, with all that being said, we have to begin by remembering something we discussed way back in the beginning of our study on God's will, and that is God has a sovereign, overarching will, and then he has a revealed will, that which he has revealed to us in nature and in his word. So, under the umbrella of that sovereign will, there are some things that you just aren't going to understand. Isaiah chapter 55. Look at verse 8. This is a verse that gets quoted a lot, or these two verses quoted a lot. Isaiah chapter 55, verses 8 and 9. The Bible says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." So, we see this also, Jesus kind of said something similar in Acts chapter 1. Go ahead and turn there. Acts chapter 1, read verse 7 and 8, where you keep in mind that when Jesus showed up, the disciples expected him to fulfill the role that they expected, and they wanted the Messiah to conquer Rome, set up the Israel as the world-dominating political power. That wasn't God's plan. So when Jesus made that clear, they continued to ask him this question. Verse 6, "When they therefore were come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times nor the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth." There's some meat there that I want to make sure you chew on. The disciples here were asking the wrong question. They wanted God to give them an answer to something that he has chosen not to let us know in his sovereign will. So what did he direct them to? His revealed will, right? It's not for you to know these things which God has under his power. You'll have the power to do what? What he's told you to do. What he's already instructed you to do. You see that focus there? So the reason why I'm bringing this out is because when we find ourselves in circumstances where either we're suffering or we see someone else suffering, especially if you have a personality like mine, you want to fix it. You want to do something. You want to help. And if we're not careful, we can find ourselves, especially in extreme circumstances, trying to offer answers that God hasn't given. Now, don't get me wrong. There are times where if you pray, if you study, if you look at things dispassionately, you can see God-given answers for some pretty horrible things. But be careful. You don't want to overstep. And there was a circumstance at school, and I was asked to come in and talk to the teachers about how to help students grieve and how to talk to students about it. And one of the things that I tried to get them to see is, speak in general terms. You don't need to take the pressure off of yourself to make everything make sense. And if you're not careful, you can become very, very counterproductive in your efforts. So mommy dies, and you know, well-intended auntie pulls a little baby off to the side, you know, 5-6-year-old girl, and says, "Well, mommy, God just needed another angel in heaven." Well, that might make you feel good to say, but then there's that little girl or that little boy saying, "God, you have plenty of angels. I only had one mom." You know what I mean? Or, "Grandpa's just up there fishing with Jesus." Well, probably not. You know? And if we're not careful, we can throw out answers that God never intended to give. We need to be well-trained, and we need to be poised, and we need to be humble. And because those sort of answers, they may be well-intended, but they're arrogant. Pride is exalting your authority, your accomplishments, or your abilities, or your understanding above what is appropriate. When you tell someone, "Well, Jesus just needed another angel," nope, that's arrogant, that's foolish, it's just not true, and that means it's destructive. And I would refer you to Deuteronomy chapter 18. Go ahead and turn there and look at that. Deuteronomy chapter 18. This is one of those scriptures that makes me nervous. And so I want to share it with you. Deuteronomy chapter 18. Look at verse 20. The Bible says this: "But the prophet which shall presume to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or that shall speak in the name of other gods, even that prophet shall die." Now, of course, this is the Old Testament. This was God speaking directly to the priesthood. But we as priests and kings, we as ambassadors for Christ, the principle is still there. We need to be very careful about what comes out of our mouths, especially when we, as the representatives of Christ, go to offer people care and comfort when they are suffering. Amen? Make sense? Just be careful. You don't have to be fearful. There's nothing wrong with just saying, "Yeah, that stinks. You know, I'm praying for you. I can't imagine how bad that hurts. I'm sorry. Can I just sit with you? Weep with you?" Be careful. All right? So, again, we have to remember that one of the difficulties in suffering is that there are times where we're hurting very badly, especially when you're dealing with death and loss, when you're dealing with natural disasters, when you're dealing with things that don't have an apparent cause, and we're very, very emotional. If we're not careful, we can find ourselves, or we can find people we care about, not just asking God to answer questions, but demanding that God answer questions that he never intended to answer, or, and this is more likely, that they couldn't possibly understand in that state of mind. Are you following along? I know the sun's going down on a Wednesday night, we all worked hard, but think about this. When you are in an emotional state, and you're demanding some sort of answer from God, or you're just lashing out, you're emotional, but you want to know why this happened. Well, first of all, maybe God, you won't know that until eternity. And maybe, even if God himself and put his arm around you and gave you the answer, you wouldn't understand it or you wouldn't be willing to accept it. Is that not true? So that's one of those dangers, and we as Christians need to recognize that if we're dealing with suffering, there are times where you just don't, it's time, don't feel the need to solve a problem. You know, can I give you just kind of an example of this? Sunday afternoon, between here and dinner or lunch, is not the time for Annie and I to solve problems. You know why? Because we're both hangry. We just recognize, and I've even caught myself, I have to discipline myself not to assess the service, not to assess you or me or the sermon until after I've eaten. Because I could get really depressed and frustrated between here and food. Now, I'm trying to be as plain and as prescriptive as possible, but does that make sense to you? And so, trying to solve very, very painful and difficult equations when you are in intense pain, it may be the right thing, but it's the wrong time. Speaking of time, time doesn't heal all wounds. But time can bring us back to a place where we're less emotional, where we're more reasonable, and we are better equipped to see and to understand. Is that not true?
Yes.
If Gene were here, he'd talk about just go out to the barn and cool down a little bit. You'll see things a little more clearly. But this idea that time heals all wounds. We were getting ready to take Abby up to Cincinnati yesterday. I dropped the other kids off with my mom and dad. And my dad, emotional, he was talking about how his uncle lost his son. And he said, I still wake up. And I hurt so bad I can't breathe. But I know that if I keep breathing, I'll get through the day, and I'll get through the next day, and the day after that. And there's some things that it's going to hurt the rest of your life. Congratulations, that's just it. You know, God in His sovereign will has seen fit for you to carry that. That's not the kind of answer we want to hear. That's outside of a perspective of an eternal God and an all-powerful God. You can't understand that. And that's why it's important for us to be very, very careful about asking questions or answering questions when we're in that sort of emotional state. Flip back to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Now, we all know this as the great... 1 Corinthians 13 is the love chapter, right? Look at these interesting verses at the end of the love chapter. Verse number 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 9. Says, for we know in part, and we prophesy, as we preach, we talk, in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spake as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. And now abide faith, hope, charity, these three, but the greatest of these is charity. Again, man, those verses right there are so doctrinally rich. There's some things we just as a child is only going to understand so much. We, even the wisest of us as human beings, compared to what we're going to understand and the perspective we're going to have 2 seconds after we're dead. We're children in our understanding. And so we need to be very careful about demanding answers or thinking or acting as if we've got it all figured out. We need to trust. Amen? Faith, hope, charity. We might have done a series on that, right? Faith, hope, charity. Hang on to those things, and that will get you through, won't it? Are those three things, if you're walking with Christ and you have a God, a Spirit-led faith, hope, and charity, you'll make it. And just a little parenthesis here. You think we're going to get to heaven and God's going to say, nah, you still don't need to know. Someday, we'll understand. Amen? We'll understand. And we're not going to get to heaven and say, God, you've done me wrong. We're not going to do that. We're going to get there and we're going to see and we're going to understand. By the way, can I give you just two examples? Abortion. I want you to try and imagine that your spouse had an abortion without your knowledge. Wow. Any abortion. How could God allow an innocent child to die? Not even get the chance to live. That's one of those that you just think, how is that possible? Is there even an answer? And if it was your child that was aborted, you might be in a position where you could say, I cannot fathom that. You probably shouldn't tackle that until you see, you can ask God in person. But if you zone out, if you look at things from a different perspective, and you look at the sheer numbers of abortion, you say, it's far worse than the Holocaust, is it not? You say, hey, Lord, how could you allow that to happen? Well, wait a minute. From the perspective of eternity, what is better for the child? To die in the womb? Or to grow up in a world that will lead him away from Christ, reject Christ, die and go to hell? Now, that's hard, isn't it? That's painful. But remember, God looks at things from an eternal perspective. And from an eternal perspective, again, I'm not justifying abortion, but I'm telling you that God is merciful and God has a plan that we would never choose, but that God is sovereign and He's allowed to work things out for His will. Here's another one. And again, I'm being mindful of time, but death of a loved one. Now, I know that there are circumstances where you see someone suffering very badly, and when they pass away, it's difficult, but you're glad that they've passed. I get that. But more often than not, they can be 138 years old, and when they die, it still hurts, and you still want them to be here. But think about it. How long should a human being, especially a righteous, holy human being, have to live and suffer in this world? I have a grandfather who's knocking on 100, and he's saying, I'm tired. I am tired of seeing my family, my kids, my nation, all the good things that I love. I'm tired of seeing them ripped apart. I know that on the other side of this life, there's heaven and there's answers. I love you guys. I'll serve you as best as I can. As long as I'm here, I'm ready to go. Would you want to stick around 200 years, 300 years? It's something to think about. Back to my notes. So, God may very well have an earthly purpose for your suffering. And if He does, we all should aggressively pursue that. Amen? Flip back to Psalm 119. I told you guys you'd be ready to jump around in the Bible tonight. Look at verse 9. Psalm 119, verse 9. Again, Psalm 119 is the longest chapter in the Bible. It's about the Bible. Psalm 119, verse 9. Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? Cleanse his way. Why? Well, because he's realizing cause and effect. He's suffering. What does it say? By taking heed according to thy word. Look at verse 28. My soul melteth for heaviness. What does that sound like? Sounds like suffering. My soul melteth for heaviness. Strengthen thou me according to thy word. Lord, I am hurting. I'm suffering. I need some sort of purpose. I find that purpose in here. Lord, what do you want? What's the purpose of this? Flip back to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Start reading in verse number 15. And again, this kind of gives us an answer for the purpose of some suffering. Who wrote 2 Corinthians? The Apostle Paul. Did he have a cushy life? Piece of cake, no problem? Or was he well acquainted with suffering? Well, what did he have to say about his own suffering? Look at verse 15 of 2 Corinthians chapter 4. For all things are for your sakes. He realized he wasn't there and left on the earth for himself. God left him there for who? The people he loved. All things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of God, for which cause we faint not. But though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Oh, we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. But the things which are seen are temporal. Somebody tell me, Isaac, what does temporal mean?
Physical,
earthly, temporal, time, temporary. But the things which are not seen are eternal. Paul recognized that though he was going through a great deal of pain, God had a purpose for his pain. He was here for a reason, and he was intensely focused on that reason. Amen? Listen, if you understand the purpose, you can go through it, right? If you know that there is a reason, if you know that on the other side of that, I'm thinking of childbirth right now. Lord have mercy. I was there. Whew. But why would any woman want to get pregnant? Knowing that that's what's going to happen. Well, because there's going to be a little baby. Right? Consider him who for the joy that was set before him or her. They endure. Why would anyone lift weights? It hurts. Well, to get stronger. Why would anybody work very hard and spend so much time working? Well, so that they can provide. So that they can retire. So, does that make sense? When you understand that there's a purpose behind it, it gives you strength, does it not? And you stay focused on that purpose. And if you don't know if you're suffering and you can't find the purpose, you need to make it a priority to look. Look for it. There will be times where God's purpose seems to be no purpose. Remember Job said, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Did he say that? Did Job know anything about suffering? Of course he did. And this is basically what he's saying. No matter what, I don't care what the suffering is, and I don't have to have all the answers. I trust him, and that's it. I like what Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said when they were facing the fiery furnace. He said, we're not careful to answer you, King Nebuchadnezzar. Our God is able to deliver us, and he will deliver us. But even if he doesn't, just know we're not bound down. No matter what. In situations where you're suffering, where it hurts, and you have no idea what God's doing, that's the worst. That's the worst. Get the death grip on the principles, the promises, the practices, the people that will keep you anchored to the rock. Just stay close to those things and those people. Stay in your word. Stay in prayer. Keep good music on. Stay around people. Don't push those things away and don't push those people away. Keep them close. Hold tightly to them so you can survive. Listen to me. This is important. When you make the mistake of pushing God away, pushing God's people away, pushing God's promises and principles away from you because you're hurting, you're adrift. And you will only tread water so long before what happens? You sink. And what? Pause for a second. Engage your imagination. What does that look like? Try to think about what that looks like. Do you know someone who's there? Something happened in their life. They didn't get the answer that they want. Don't talk to me about God. Don't talk to me about church. Don't talk to me. Where was God when? Well, he was there. Because he didn't give you the answer you wanted. Because you didn't reach out for the things that were available to you. Because you thought you were going to do it on your own, in your own strength. You sunk. You need to be very, very careful about that. Don't make that mistake. And that's why if you must offer something, offer truth. Just offer to be there. Alright? And again, I want to give some time to talk about this afterward. But, let's move on. So, and again, we'll discuss this more at length later on in our study. But for now, let's take a different perspective. Let's shift out to a broader perspective on suffering. A logical, reasonable person, when you're not overwhelmed with emotion, it's relatively easy to see that at a very fundamental level, pain and suffering serve to teach us cause and effect, right? And again, this is very, very basic, very, very simple, not as heavy, but God has put us in a world of cause and effect. Gravity is good, is it not?
Yes.
What would happen if we didn't have gravity? But what does gravity do when you're driving too fast? Or when you slip and fall? Yeah. Fire is good. But fire, if you get too close, it hurts. The sun is great. Anybody ever had a sunburn? I have. Water, fantastic. Can't live without it. But what happens when that little child gets away from mom and dad around the pool? The internet is a very good thing. But wireless can be a very good thing, right? But, it can be a bad thing too. Medication, pain pills, it can be a good thing, but they can be a bad thing. And here's the thing, we have to learn to interact in this world with those elements within the limits and the boundaries that God has set forth. Now let that truth just sink in. Most of the things around you are good. And they have a purpose. The key is to keep them within their purpose. Are you ready for just something simple? I don't know about you, but every once in a while you eat dinner and there's just something nice and simple and easy. Easy to digest, but very nutritious. Are you ready for that in Scripture? Turn back to Proverbs. I just want to share these two things. These nail this point down. And they're simple, easy to understand, easy to digest, but so very powerful. Proverbs 25, look at verse 16. Proverbs 25:16. Hast thou found honey? Eat so much as is sufficient for thee, lest thou be filled therewith and vomit it. Now, honey's a good thing, isn't it? Sweet, good, what it can be used for, wonderful. But have you ever eaten too much sugar or too much sweets? Yeah. See how balanced that is? Well, what could be more simple than honey? But don't overdo it. Another one that's just as simple but more on the painful side, Proverbs chapter 6, 27 and 28. Can a man take fire in his bosom and his clothes not be burned? Can one go upon hot coals and his feet not be burned? All right, what's that saying? Fire is great, but don't touch it. Okay? Now again, I know this is simple. I know this is so simple it could go right over our heads. But the point is, we live in a wonderful world with more available to us than ever before. The problem is, what are we as Americans, what is the number one thing that we face? Temperance, self-control. We have so much. You could eat and eat and eat and eat yourself sick. You could have so much. You could. The biggest problem in your day could be choosing which of the many options you're going to take. And we have a real problem with, and many of the pains that we feel aren't that we don't have, it's that we're taking too much. That we're taking a good thing or the right thing, but with too much in the wrong context. So, water's good, right? How do we learn to operate within the boundaries that God has set forth? Well, God's given us parents. God's given us pastors. He's given us professionals that help us, that teach us how to interact with these various good things in life without sinking, without getting ourselves into trouble. But make no mistake, nothing teaches us how to interact in this world like pain. Your mommy and daddy can tell you not to touch the stove till they are blue in the face. But yet, when you touch it, you know. Correct? Your mommy and daddy can tell you don't eat too much sugar. But then when you go ahead and do that and you get sick, then you just, it's not a matter of being told. You know you've experienced that. And of course, old Ben Franklin, right? Experience is a dear school, but a fool learns it no other. You know, I would refer you to Proverbs chapter 17. Flip back there. Proverbs chapter 17. Let's look at a couple of these verses here. Proverbs 17. Again, let this scripture sink in. Proverbs 17, look at verse 10. A reproof. What is a reproof? A correction. A verbal correction. A reproof entereth more into a wise man than 100 stripes into a fool. Aiden, what does he mean by stripes? Yeah. So, you take a fool and you take a wise person. You know what it means, right? Hey, you ought not do that. Okay. Versus having to get beat and hurt. You ever met someone who just won't learn? How many times are you going to smash your finger in the door? How many times are you going to do that? Versus someone who you tell them once and they just got it. Well, what do you want to be? What do you want your kids to be? Wise. That's why we got to teach them young. Proverbs chapter 23. Proverbs chapter 23, look at verse 35. This verse just scares me to death. Proverbs 23:35. They have stricken me, shalt thou say, and I was not sick. They've beaten me, and I felt it not. When shall I awake? I'll seek it yet again. What's that verse talking about? Addiction. Specifically, alcohol addiction. One of the worst things that could happen to you is to get into a position where you are so far removed, where you're so focused on that appetite that it doesn't matter how bad it hurts, you're going to go for it. We've been there, right? Remember this one? I'm seeing faces, so we'll go ahead and show it. Let's see if I can pull it up. Ryan, you might have to hit it.
It's just, there's all this pressure, you know? And sometimes it feels like it's right up on me. And I can just feel it, like literally feel it in my head, and it's relentless, and I don't know if it's going to stop. I mean, that's the thing that scares me the most, is that I don't know if it's ever going to stop.
Yeah. Well, you do have a nail in your head.
It is not about the nail.
Are you sure? Because, I mean, I'll bet if we got that out of there...
Stop trying to fix it.
No, I'm not trying to fix it. I'm just pointing out that maybe the nail is causing...
You always do this. You always try to fix things when what I really need is for you to just listen.
See, I don't think that is what you need. I think what you need is to get the nail...
See, you're not even listening now.
Okay, fine. I will listen. Fine.
It's just... sometimes it's like there's this achy, I don't know what it is, and I'm not sleeping very well at all, and all my sweaters are snagged, I mean all of them.
On, if you would just
don't
try to sleep.
So,
it's just,
have you ever been in that situation?
Yeah.
You know, human beings, we can be very hard-headed, can't we? We can be very hard-headed, and we can find ourselves in a situation where here's the real problem: either our pride or our lust. Let that sink in. Our pride, don't tell me, or our lust, I've already decided, I've already thought it through, and I want that, causes us to drive past pain barriers, God-given pain barriers, and our appetites blind us to cause and effect. It's a very frustrating, difficult thing to watch someone you love be in a position where you're not even allowed to talk about, you're not allowed to talk about that. Because you're not allowed to mess with my pride. Well, sometimes love dictates that you be humbled. Say, you have done something foolish, and you've gotten a nail stuck in your head, and it's just gonna hurt. By the way, guys, have you ever been in that situation where you get a piece of glass or something, and you'd love to just be able to pick that thing out yourself, but you just can't get it, and you have to go ask someone to do it for you. Oh, that's frustrating. Does God do that? Does God do that on purpose? Allow things to happen to you that force you to admit that not only did you do something stupid, but the consequences you can't fix on your own. And you need him, you need someone else. Yeah, God does that. That's part of the purpose of pain. Our lusts. You know, when you or I or someone we care about gets to this place where we have already decided that we've chosen sin, we've chosen lust, it doesn't matter that having that thing is worth whatever the consequences. And we're willing to fight whoever and whatever gets in our way of having what we want or thinking of ourselves the way we want to think of ourselves. You're in a dangerous place. You're in a very dangerous place. Matthew chapter 23. Almost done here, and we'll have some time for discussion. Matthew chapter 23. Now again, while you're turning there, I want you to recognize something. Right now, we're not talking about right and wrong. We're not talking about relationships. We're not talking about good, better, and best. We're not talking about performance. We're still simply talking about cause and effect. Like I said, all suffering has its root in sin. Maybe not your sin, maybe not their sin, but there is a cause and effect. If you are hurting, there is a cause. And we need to try to find it. Matthew chapter 23, look at verse 37. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest them which are sent unto thee, how often would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathereth her chickens under her wings, and ye would not. Jesus showed up, was prepared, but it had to be on his terms. That was the nation of Israel. If you're not going to give us what we want, how we want it, then we don't want to hear from you. We don't care what you have to say or how you're going to say it. We want what we want. What'd they get? What happened in 70 A.D., Isaac? Yeah. Titus destroyed Jerusalem, just like Jesus said. When we do this, when we get ourselves in a position where we've decided what we want and we don't care what it costs us, what we do is we set off a domino effect in our lives. Usually it starts with us, our health, our self-respect. It translates to our relationships. And unfortunately, it ends with even our Savior. I want you to pause and think about this. So I'm kind of in this situation right now where we are as a family with Abby. We're trying to figure out what's going on with Abby. We don't know yet what exactly is going on. And again, I'm just being hypothetical here. What if there was something environmental? What if there was something... If a neurologist told us yesterday that, you know what, for some strange reason, it is the Wi-Fi in your house, and you need to get rid of that. Would we be okay with that? Would we say, okay, yep, our daughter's health is worth that, we're going to drop it? You would think yes. I got news for you. We live in a world, and I'm in a family, we are addicted to the internet. People say, oh, Pastor, don't get legalistic. Sugar and salt, and I like my standard American diet, right? Don't tell me I should eat. Don't give me all that conspiracy theory and all that fluoride in the water and all that. Don't tell me about that stuff. And blah, 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 blah. I'm going to live the way I want to live, and I'm not going to worry about all that stuff. But then when you get cancer, it's, oh, Pastor, oh, there's no rhyme or reason to it. Just can't figure out how or why God would allow such a horrible thing to befall me and my family. After we live a lifetime of, don't talk about that stuff. Now listen, I'm not God. I'm not your judge. You're allowed to live your life however you want. I'm going to tell you something. We are going to stand before God, and God's going to make it very clear. You lived in a dark, fallen world that did everything it could. It attacked you at every angle. And guess what? This is what happened to you. You were careless. You chose not to worry about the truth. You chose not to believe the truth. You chose to just trust that this world had your best interest at heart. And don't blame me for the consequences. Think about that. Are there people who are mad at God because their father died of lung cancer when he smoked like a freight train his whole life? Does that happen? Yeah. Now again, that's just one example, and there are many. My friends, here's another very damaging part of this. You ever been in a situation where you're trying to help somebody and they tell you, look, I hear what you're saying, I disagree, or I don't care, and so I'm going to do this, and if this happens, fine, you can say you told me so, but I'm going to go live my life, I'm going to do my thing. And then that happens. How do you feel? Oh, you poor person, let me come help you. Is that how you feel? Or are you feeling, you idiot? I tried to tell you. That's how you feel, isn't it? Now, partially, that's not good. But to a certain extent, listen, I'm trying to think of time, but if you were to go to like Romans chapter 1, you see that there does come a point where God Himself says, all right, I'm going to give you over to... If that's what you want, go ahead. Knock yourself out. Does God do that? Because we are supposed to be Christ-like. We're supposed to love as Christ loves. And does God, does he come and force us and say, no, you will not eat in an inappropriate way? Does he do that? No. Does he force his will upon us? No. He lets us, he warns us, he loves us and says, look, I'm trying to tell you, I'm not going to make you, but. And again, God's compassionate and loving and kind. But my friends, here's the thing, and we need to understand this as Christians, both for, as beer being and building Christians. You cannot ignore the laws of gravity and then expect God to change the laws of gravity because you happen to decide to jump off of something that's too high. And if you will think objectively at a lot of different circumstances, what you will find and what you will see, and it's a very difficult and frustrating to see this, is when you see people asking for prayer, and again, I'm not trying to be saying that we shouldn't pray for people, we certainly should, but there comes a you will find that as you get better at recognizing cause and effect in this world, you will see people who have brought things on themselves, and they're asking God to perform a miracle when it is God that set the world up the way he set it up to hurt when you do that. And God is not going to change the laws of physics because you refuse to learn. Even if that means death. And so, Christians, if we really love, then we'll teach them young. Hey, look, don't do that. Amen?
Amen?
And beyond that, we will tactfully, lovingly, with good timing, appropriately offer cause and effect when we see it. And again, going back to the nail thing. You know what? The reason why that video, you may only get half of it. It is true that there are times where what that person needs at that moment is just for you to listen. It's not time to pull the nail out. It's not even time to point it out. It's time to say, okay, that sounds painful. And that's all you need to say right then and there. All right, so I'm going to stop and then offer up time for discussion.
Questions, thoughts, comments?